Harper Audio presents Fatal Flaw by William Lashner. Read by Peter Francis James. Guy Forrest was sitting on the cement steps outside the house when I arrived. His head was hidden in his hands. Rain fell in streams from his shoulders, his knees, tumbled off the roof of his brow. He was slumped naked in the rain, and beside his feet lay the gun. From his nakedness and the diagonal despair of his posture, I suspected the worst. "Guy, what did you do?" I shouted at him over the thrumming rain. His voice was like the whimpering of a beaten dog. "I loved her. I loved her. I loved her." Then I no longer suspected. Then I knew. I leaned over and lifted the gun by the trigger guard. No telling what more damage he could do with it. Careful to leave no prints, I placed it in my outside raincoat pocket. The door to the house was thrown open. I stepped inside. Later on in the press, the house would be described as a love nest. But there was really nothing fancy or decadent about it. It was just a modest old stone house in a crowded Philadelphia suburb just over City Line Avenue. The walls were bare, the furnishings sparse. There was a sense of biding time, of making do until real life with real furniture began. The bedroom, that's where I would find her. Rain dripped off my coat like tears as I climbed the stairway. As I rose ever closer, my steps slowed. A complex scent pressed itself upon me, like a smothering pillow. I could detect the sharpness of cordite and something sweet beneath that. Jasmine. And then something else, something coppery and sour, something desolate. A few steps higher and then to the left, to the master bedroom. The door was open. The bedroom light was on. She lay on the bed, her frail, pale body twisted strangely among the clotted sheets. Her legs were covered by the dark blue comforter, but it was pulled down far enough to reveal her cream silk teddy, shamelessly raised above her naked belly. Crimson spotted the blanched white of her skin. The teddy was stained red at the heart. The sight of her unnatural posture, the colliding sense of gunpowder, of blood and jasmine, the brutal mark of violence on her chest, all of it, the very configuration of her death, overwhelmed me. I was lost in a long emotional vision, but when I recovered enough to function, a decision had been made, an implacable decision, yet pure and right. A decision had been made, and for the rest of my involvement in that death and its grisly aftermath, that decision guided my every step, starting with the first. I took a deep breath and entered the bedroom. I leaned over the bed and stared closely at her face. Her name was Hailey Prouix. Black hair, blue eyes, long-necked and pale-skinned. She was 30 years old and lovely as a siren. While still alive, she had peered out at the world with a wary detachment. She had seen too much to take anything at face value, her manners said as clear as words. She had been hurt too much to expect anything other than blows. She wore sharp, dark-rimmed glasses that were all business, but her mouth curved so achingly you couldn't look at it without wanting to take it into your own. And her stare, containing as it did both warning and dare, could weaken knees. To gaze at Hailey Prouix was to have your throat tighten with the wanting, and not just sexual wanting, though that, of course, was part of it, but something even more powerful. There is inevitably, I suppose, a gap between all we ever wanted and all we ever will have, and that gap can be a source of bitter regret. But sometimes there is a glimpse of hope that the gap might be narrowed, might even be obliterated by one brilliant leap. In Hailey Prouix's detached beauty and the silent dare to break through her barriers, there was a glimpse of that hope. Oh, yes, she was a siren. And like a siren, she had drawn Guy Forrest from his wife and two children, from his high-powered lawyer's job, from his finely appointed mini-mansion deep in the suburbs. And now, I suppose, as was inevitable from the first, he had crashed upon the shoals. Next to the bed on a night table, along with their glasses, an alarm clock, and a lamp, sat two phones, a small red cellular thing, and an old-style corded phone. If anyone saw me arrive at the house, I didn't want there to be too much of a time discrepancy between when I entered and when 911 logged the call, so I picked up the handset of the line-locked phone, dialed 911, and reported the murder. Then I went to work. I'm a criminal lawyer. People like Guy Forrest, in the depths of the deepest troubles of their lives, call me in to clean up their messes. It's what I do. It is my calling, and I'm damn good at it. I reach my hand into the mess, rummage around, and pull out evidence. I accept what evidence I must, discredit what I can, hide what I might, create what I need, and from this universe of evidence, I build a story. Sometimes the story is true, more often not, but truth is never the standard. Better the credible lie than the implausible truth. The story need only be persuasive enough to clean up the mess. But I don't always win, thank God. Some messes are too big to be cleaned. Some stains can never be rubbed out. Some crimes call out for more than a story. And some victims deserve nothing less than the truth. Knowing the police would arrive in minutes, in seconds, the first thing I did was grab the cellular phone off the night table and dump it into my pocket. Then I took a quick look around. In the bathroom, soapy water still filled the jacuzzi tub, gray and wide, with its water jets now quiet. A Sony CD Walkman and a large pair of Koss headphones sat on the rim. I took a look in the medicine cabinet, but there was nothing unusual or remarkable to be found there. Back in the bedroom, I started opening drawers. Not much in the bureau other than clothes. Under the clothes in the middle drawer was an envelope, filled with cash. New hundreds. 2,000, 3,000. I counted it quickly and put it back. The top drawer of the desk held stamps, pens, business cards, golf tees, loose change, and Haley's driver's license. It had expired 18 months ago. The picture didn't really look like her. She was scowling. The glasses were less than flattering. Hailey Prouix was glamorous and cosmopolitan. This woman in this picture looked anything but. Still, I took it anyway, put it in my pocket as a keepsake. And then, in one of the other drawers, I spotted a little paper box filled with change, staples, a staple remover, paper clips, keys. Keys. I was tempted to take them all. There was no telling what secrets lay behind their locks, but I had to leave something for the detectives. So I took only one, slipped it in my pocket with a license before closing the drawer. As I searched, I tried not to think of the body on the bed. When I remember back, I am amazed that I could still move with such alacrity, still make snap determinations. I am stunned at my level of functioning. If it all sounds so calm and deliberate, so bloody cold-blooded, then that is only the voice of the remembering, for I assure you, my knees were shaking uncontrollably as I moved about that room. But a decision had been made, and that had calmed me some. At the head of the stairs, I took one last look at Hailey Prouix, wiped at my eyes, climbed slowly down. From the hallway closet, I removed Guy's black raincoat. He was still collapsed on the steps, naked, drenched. I gently placed the raincoat over his body and squatted beside him. It was strangely peaceful on that suburban street, except for the stutter of the dying rain and Guy's weeping. I stayed silent for a moment, let the rain cleanse the bitter scent from my eyes. "Why did you kill her, Guy?" I said finally. No response. I slapped the side of his head. "Tell me."
"I didn't," he said through his sobs. "I loved her. I gave up everything for her."
"I know, Guy.
I swear, I didn't kill her. I didn't."
"You'll be all right, Guy. I'll do what I can. The police are on the way. Do not talk to them. Do not say anything to the police until we can talk first."
Victor. God, I loved her so much.
I know you did, Guy. I know you did. That was the problem. I was still squatting next to him when came the cars with their sirens and their flashing lights, and the three of us, Guy and Hailey and I, were no longer alone. Guy Forrest was sitting now at the dining room table, his head in his hands. He was a handsome man, Guy Forrest. Wavy dark hair, swarthy good looks, classic bone structure. He worked out regularly, always had, even when we were law students together. But even so, there was something weak about him. His chin was too sharp, his gaze too wavering. Looking at Guy, you had the sense you were looking at a Hollywood facade of what a man should look like, perfect on the outside. But one stiff breeze would blow him down. And now he had been beset by a hurricane. It had grown crowded in and about that little house. Someone upstairs was taking pictures. Someone upstairs was dusting for fingerprints and swabbing for blood. Someone outside in the rain was examining the windows and flower beds for signs of forced entry. Television vans were on the street in force. The noose was already tightening around Guy Forrest's neck, and there was precious little I could do about it.
"Mr. Carl, is it?"
said a tall, good-looking woman in jacket and pants who entered the room. She referred to her notepad as she spoke. "That's right," I said.
"And Mr. Forrest?"
Guy raised his head, looked at the woman, said nothing. His eyes were impressively red-rimmed, the eyes of the seriously bereaved. "As you can understand," I said, "it's been a very difficult evening for us all."
"Of course," said the young woman. "I'm County Detective Stone. With me is County Detective Brieger."
She gestured at the man standing behind her. He was a good 3 decades older than she, with a sad face and plaid jacket. His shoulders were thick and rounded. He was a great hunch of a man. There was something soft about Brieger, something tired, as if he had grown comfortable in a routine that was being shattered by his younger, more enthusiastic partner.
"I am sorry for your loss, Mr. Forrest," said Detective Brieger, even as he continued his inspection of the room. "I have been doing this now for 36 years, and it is still a tough thing to see."
Guy tried to get a thank you past his quivering jaw and failed.
"Miss Prue was what to you, Mr. Forrest?"
asked Stone.
"Your girlfriend?"
"His fiancee," I said.
"Fiancee," said Brieger. "Oh, hell, that is a tough one. When was the wedding supposed to be?"
"As soon as Mr. Forrest's divorce came through," I said. Stone shot me a look.
"Mr. Carl, you're a friend, an advisor, what?"
"I am a friend of Mr. Forrest, but I am also a lawyer. Mr. Forrest called me when he found Miss Prue on the bed. I'm here as a friend," I said. "But a friend who knows that when a man is in shock over the death of a loved one, maybe it's not the best time to be talking to the police."
"It is, if the goal is to get the bastard who did this before the trail grows cold. We have questions for Mr. Forrest."
"I don't think he'd be much help in his current condition."
"Seems to me you're acting more like a lawyer than a friend."
"For the moment, yes. That's how I'm going to handle it." Stone smiled.
"At some point, we will need to ask Mr. Forrest some questions."
"Mr. Forrest is still in something of a daze. Could your questioning of him wait until tomorrow?"
"If that's what you think best," said Brieger.
"I do."
"Of course you do," said Brieger. "Mr. Forrest is going through an ordeal. His fiancée is dead in their bed, a bullet wound in her chest. Any of us would be in shock. You want him to be able to pull himself together before he speaks to us."
"How's tomorrow morning?"
said Stone as she handed me her card.
"I think that would be all right. I'm going to take Mr. Forrest to my apartment for the night."
"If it is any consolation, Mr. Forrest," said Brieger, looking straight at Guy now, "we are going to do our best to get the bastard who did this. We will put all our resources into digging out the truth, and believe us, dig it out we will."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.